Hey, what's up? It's Comic95 the Savior, and for this video, I will be giving students 10 of my personal tips for finding a job while you are here in Japan. Do keep in mind that this video is for part-time workers that are on student visas. I made a separate video in which I talked about something that people don't talk about much, which is the difficulty in getting visa sponsorship to switch from having a student visa to a work visa. I talk about my own personal struggle doing so. If you don't know my story of being here in Japan, I started off here on a student visa going to Lakeland University, Japan. So I'm speaking from personal experience. I do currently have a bachelor's degree and I've been working full-time for over a year, but I've definitely been in your shoes before in which I was struggling to find both a full-time job and part-time job. So first things first, let's talk about the legal issues. On a student visa, you are not allowed to legally work. But I will also be honest with you, there's no one really checking your visa to make sure you have permission to work. But it's really easy to legally obtain it, and I do suggest you do things the legal way. So in order to get permission to work, you can easily fill out an application online, take it to immigration, in which you request permission to be able to work here part-time legally. Legally, the work you can do in Japan cannot involve anything that has to do with sex, media such as modeling, any type of, you know, career like that. So don't be fooled by these girls that you see here doing modeling gigs, etc. on the side. I guarantee you that 9 out of 10 of them are either 1, married, or 2, they are actually breaking the law and risking getting deported or fined, or both. So don't follow their footsteps. You are not legally allowed to do these things. Adult videos, you know, any type of sex work, sugar daddy type stuff. Yeah, don't do that. Don't get involved with that. Only girls that are on a work visa. You also notice that a lot of women here that are, you know, working here as models or kawaii models, whatever they want to call themselves, they're super secretive about their dating and their sex life. And a lot of them are actually married and pretending to be single to get both Japanese male followers, as well as to maintain the innocent image that Japanese models are supposed to have, which is being this virgin, innocent, doll-like girl who has never had sex because you're this magical, angelic version. But that's not what this video is about. I'm here to give you 10 tips to pretty much help you get a job. Very common sense, basic stuff that I personally found helpful that maybe some of you have not thought of. If you are here on a student visa, maybe you've been here for a minute and didn't know this stuff, or maybe you are someone that is coming to Japan and you haven't even thought this far ahead. So of course, for someone that has been here for a minute, this video won't really apply to you because you've already learned all of this stuff because you've been here for a minute. And as always, depending on where you live, depending on how much money you have, depending on your country of origin, your language skills, you may agree or disagree with certain points that I mentioned, but this is my own personal opinion and what has worked out for me and my friends. I also want to add that I am a Black woman, in case you can't already tell. I'm American, I'm a native English speaker, and I came to Japan when I was a young adult. I'm still young, but just giving you an idea, because obviously those things can shape, mold, or whatever your chances or way of, you know, searching for a job. I am not and was not married, and I do not and did not have any children. I was single, and I was living in a share house at this time when I was doing all of this stuff. So there's no aid, nothing helping me. My parents don't have money. I didn't have money. Like, there was no one like helping me with this process. It's all me, all my ideas, all my stuff. So let's get to it. Number one. Study Japanese. So yes, while I will say in all honesty, Japanese is not super beneficial after you get a degree, because most jobs here either don't want you to speak Japanese at all, they prefer that you don't know it, or two, you won't be paid more for knowing Japanese, even for the jobs that require it. It's generally just a requirement for the work, and it doesn't necessarily equal more pay in most circumstances. And once again, generally, even for the jobs that give you more pay, the amount is so minuscule that it wasn't worth it to have learned the language. Don't get me wrong, I'm not discouraging you from learning Japanese, but I will say the payoff is very slim after graduating. However, before graduating as a student, knowing Japanese puts you a gazillion steps ahead of foreigners that don't know Japanese, because a lot of jobs are only available to people that can either speak Japanese fluently or at least at a basic level. So yes, learning Japanese, but not just in any way, comprehension skills. You want to be able to understand spoken Japanese. Being able to read and write is not super helpful, because if you're working in a restaurant environment, for example, or working in any environment, you know, like retail, etc., you're going to be listening to people and having to help them by doing what they're asking you to do. Not so much giving your own opinion, not so much giving your own interpretation of things, not so much writing or even reading stuff. So you will also be tested mostly on your comprehension skills and not so much in writing. They don't expect you to know kanji, but you probably will be expected to know some very basic kanji and maybe some very, you know, obviously basic Japanese, like being able to read hiragana, katakana, and do simple things like maybe write your name. So that's about it, but it's also not a need for part-time jobs here. There are plenty of jobs you can get without speaking a lick of Japanese. I know firsthand because I didn't know any Japanese when I got all of the part-time jobs that I had. So I am being honest with you though and saying that by knowing Japanese fluently or even having a basic understanding at an N5, N4 level, it definitely does open up a lot of opportunities for you for part-time jobs in which it is worth it to learn. Number two, build up your resume by doing volunteer work and freelancing. So you might be thinking like, what? Why would I want to do volunteer work? This will pay off in the long run because your goal is to not only expand your resume, but to expand it here in Japan. As a student, you probably haven't been here for a very long time, and you probably lack a lot of teaching experience as well as work experience, period, specifically in Japan. Japanese people don't really care about the work you did abroad. They're worried about how well you can work with other Japanese people or even other foreigners in their country. So the more work that you have under your belt, the more it helps you. Now, of course, you can lie on your resume and do something crazy like that, which I don't suggest or recommend, but you will ultimately hurt yourself in the long run because it really does benefit you by having actual legitimate job experience because you learn how to deal with different circumstances, you learn different Japanese by working at these different companies, whether it be through volunteer, unpaid work, or you know, low-paid jobs, etc. For myself, I found it super beneficial to have gotten experience teaching private English lessons on my own before taking up a real part-time job working at an Eikaiwa. Because I'd already had experience teaching private English lessons to several different students, I knew what to expect, I knew the struggles that my students had with learning, you know, English, I knew about the difficulties with things like L and R, and you know, even like other letters, etc., like B and V, like things like that that I was not aware of. I learned about cultural differences with how they talk and how they, you know, expect lessons to go and their shyness and what they want to learn for work. There's a lot of stuff that you can learn. And of course, freelancing gives you the opportunity to work around your own schedule. The downside is, of course, you will probably have to charge less than your, you know, counter, you know, teachers or other teachers that are here on, you know, work visas, etc., who can work more hours than you can and that have more experience and more qualifications than you do. So that can definitely be something that you find a challenge. But again, I'm teaching you how to get some part-time side income. You're not going to be able to make a full salary off of doing this for most people, but the extra money that you bring in is definitely worth it for you as a student here in Japan. Keep in mind, once again, you're only legally allowed to work 28 hours during the school year, and you're supposed to have pretty much perfect or near perfect attendance. However, during the summer holiday or any type of vacation time, you are allowed to work up to 40 hours full-time work, but most companies do not allow you to do that still. They will only allow you to work 28 hours to make sure that they stay safe because they don't want to be fined or get in trouble for, you know, allowing you to do illegal work. They will be hit harder than you are to basically teach an example of them because, once again, they're a Japanese company. They're responsible to make sure that they follow the law, so they should not be hiring you. However, as an individual, you will be hit the hardest because it will cost you your stay here in Japan. So kind of backtracking, do be careful and make sure you're working for a company that is legally abiding the law and following the rules. I know it might be tempting to take advantage, you know, of the fact that, you know, you can work this place illegally, do crazy stuff. I'm not, you know, gonna go into a lot of detail about myself, but let's just say I'm speaking from experience. I have not gotten in trouble for anything, but again, I will be honest with you. Let's just say I've had opportunities to work under the table. I don't suggest that you take them up though. Number three, make sure anytime you have an opportunity to work for someone that you try your best to ask and or, you know, obtain a letter of recommendation. Japanese people love stamps and letters like way more than people do in America. Anything that you have that shows proof that you've worked for a company and that you did a great job will definitely help you out in the long run and will definitely make your job search significantly easier. As a student, you have a lot of disadvantages. It doesn't matter what you're studying. I'll talk about that in a later point, how you can use that to your advantage too. But generally speaking, companies don't care. They want to see what you have now, not what you plan to get in the future. So definitely go out of your way to get letters of recommendations from anyone you volunteer for, anyone you work for, any, you know, teacher that, you know, teaches you. If you're a student of theirs, ask them for a letter of recommendation. Do whatever you can to benefit yourself. I promise you, you can never have too many letters of recommendations. So always try to be a star student so that you can get one from potentially every teacher that you have. Like, those letters really add up. They help you if you choose to go to another school. They help you when you're looking for your career. They help you when looking for part-time work. They're truly a lifesaver and they cost you nothing. Number 4, make connections by attending expat and international parties and events, as well as religious organizations like churches, youth groups, etc. You'll be amazed at how many people you can meet, both Japanese and foreigner alike, where you'll find someone that either owns a business, knows of a company, etc. that's hiring and that actually pays quite a lot. Everybody that's working here as a student in Japan is not only not struggling because their parents have money, but a lot of these people found a good part-time job in which they're making a semi-full-time salary. I literally have met students here, myself included, that have been able to work where they're making like $2,000 or, you know, $1,900 a month in comparison to the average student here working part-time that's making even less than that, without even putting in that many hours. Like, I literally have worked a Saturday job where they were paying me $2,000 a month just to work on Saturday from 8 a.m. to about 2 p.m. And that was in Tokyo, you guys. So that was pretty crazy. That wasn't, you know, including with my restaurant job that I was doing. So that really, really helped me out and made it possible for me to pay. I was paying like $600+ for rent when I was living in Narima, Tokyo. So yeah, keep that in mind, that you can definitely find good jobs by making connections with other foreigners that are, you know, going to these international parties, going to these expat events, going, you know, to all types of different stuff here, like religious organizations. Do not underestimate the church in Japan. If you happen to be a Christian or a Muslim and you go to a mosque or you go to, you know, a church or any type of, you know, group that, you know, your whatever religious organization has, you can definitely make a lot of connections with both people that are a part of your organization, religion, and even from your own country. You'll be amazed at how many small companies are here from your home country. For example, there are lots of Americans that own schools here. There are lots of people from Turkey that have their own small schools here, etc. So there's cultural centers here. There's Indian schools here. There's people from the Philippines that have whole franchise schools. So there's all types of different stuff that you will only know about if you actually get out there, make foreign friends, go to church, meet other Japanese people. You'll find the kindest, sweetest people at these places. So I highly suggest it. It will help you both for, you know, looking for part-time jobs now, getting recommendations, and even for finding work in the future. Maybe they can't hire you now, but after you graduate, they would love to have you on board. Number 5, scour job listings on Craigslist as well as Gaijinpot. I know a lot of you guys are like, I already know this, but oh my god, I promise you a lot of you guys don't use this like how you should. A lot of people, believe it or not, are not aware of Craigslist Japan. Craigslist exists in Osaka as well as Tokyo, as well as all of the other major cities here in Japan, and a lot of people do actually post legitimate jobs. In fact, I find the jobs in there to be more legit than the job listings that we have in the US. You're very unlikely to come across scams or, you know, fake job listings, etc. Of course, those things do exist, so do be careful with the information that you do send over, but I can guarantee you that most posts are legitimate and you can find really good jobs there. The best part-time job I ever had actually came from a Craigslist at, believe it or not. So again, don't underestimate them, and same thing goes for Gaijinpot. I believe, in my opinion, these two places have the most job listings and the most reliable job listings and the highest, you know, salaries, and are more desperate to hire people, which all works in your favor. I will say that obviously both sites, especially Gaijinpot, lean more towards people that have, you know, a bachelor's degree and are looking more for full-time teachers, but you can definitely find part-time work. And again, that's where volunteering comes in handy. Don't be afraid to volunteer. Nobody wants to say no to free labor. Everyone benefits from it. If you are willing to volunteer for a company and show that you are a good employee, you're good to them, you're a great volunteer, they would love to hire you in the future when a position does become available, and they might be willing to pay you even more money because now they know your character, you've been an asset, a valuable asset to their country, well, that too, but to their company. And, you know, of course, as soon as a position is open, they're going to go for you instead of posting a job listing saying that they're looking for a part-time worker or they're looking for a full-time worker. They would rather hire from within somebody that's already been faithful and has shown that they're reliable to that company. So again, don't underestimate Craigslist. Don't underestimate Gaijinbot, because the other good thing is too, on Craigslist, you'll find a lot of jobs that don't exist on Gaijinbot. A lot of people go to Craigslist because it doesn't cost any money to advertise their job listing. And they have, you know, the anonymous like nature of it, where they don't have to say the company's name or whatever, which can seem a little bit, you know, not, how can I put it? May seem a little bit suspicious, doesn't seem like it's legit, but I promise you 9 out of 10, if not 10 out of 10 of these postings, they are real, they are legitimate, they're real schools, and it's not fake. And again, these are listings that normally you don't have a lot of competition for, because most people aren't thinking to look on Craigslist for a job. Gaijinbot does have a ton of competition. It is known for being the number one place for foreigners to apply. But do keep in mind, most foreigners that use Gaijinbot are using it from outside of Japan. So if you're already within Japan, that already puts you like 10 steps ahead of the average applicant that they receive. Most of their applications are from people that are, one, not native English speakers, and two, that, you know, aren't here, you know, actually like on a legitimate visa. Like, they don't have a student visa. They're here on a tourist visa trying to flip it over, etc. So you're already steps ahead of these people by just that, and they do have part-time job listings on there. And again, you can always reach out to these companies individually or collectively and explain that you're looking for volunteer work. And again, most places will not say no to free labor. Number 6, search for and apply to foreign restaurants here in Japan. I think a lot of people forget that a lot of the places here aren't really advertising to hire, but they are hiring. A lot of these places are in desperate need of, you know, how can I put it, low-skilled labor workers. There's a shortage of Japanese people that are willing to work for these companies. The population is aging, and a lot of people here don't find it necessary to work part-time while they are studying in school because they live at home with their parents, unless they're from out of town or whatever. And even in those situations, oftentimes their parents might still be supporting them and paying for everything, or they've taken out loans, so they're not in your position because they're also not overseas like how you are. And then with these foreign restaurants, these owners have been in your position before. They came here as students, or they came here, you know, working illegally on a tourist visa. They want to help you out. I personally use both my race and my nationality to my advantage. I personally looked for black restaurants, black businesses. I looked for any African shop that I can find. I looked for any black restaurant that I could find. And sure enough, I came across the jobs that I had when I was working in Tokyo. They worked out in my advantage. I found companies that specifically wanted to either hire foreign workers that needed English staff, whatever the case happened to be, that wanted to have a black presence. You don't have to be black to get jobs at these places, but I'm telling you how I did my job search. You can do the same thing. If you're a Jamaican, if you're German, you know, if you're French, wherever you come from, I promise you there's at least one, if not several, businesses from other people that are from your country that exist here in Japan. And maybe it's not your specific country, but again, the fact that it is a foreign-owned business, they normally want to help other foreigners out. They want to give you a job opportunity. They could benefit from someone that's willing to work for them, especially if you happen to be bilingual and you can speak both English and Japanese. Once again, you're a valuable asset to their company. You might not necessarily be paid more money, but again, the goal is for you to get a job, have stable work, stable money. So don't just do a general job search, how to find a job in Japan, or just apply to schools. Don't forget that, you know, there's more restaurants here than just the yakiniku place or, you know, that gaijin bar or whatever. Do not underestimate foreign gaijin businesses here in Japan. Number 7, search for and apply to foreign-owned private English language schools here in Japan. So a lot of people, when they think of Eikaiwas, they think of like Aeon, and they think of Nova and GABA, etc., or Shane. Those are great companies, yeah. But let's be real, the best companies to work for are actually the privately owned ones. They generally offer significantly more salary, they're more flexible with vacation days, the staff is generally nicer, they care about you more as an employee, and unlike all those other schools that, you know, mass hire, these places love to hire students because they're only looking for part-time workers to begin with. They generally want to avoid having to do things like worry about your health insurance, etc. They want to get, you know, around legal loopholes, etc. So they basically don't want to hire you for the right reason, but at least they treat you well as an employee. employee and they definitely pay you what you're worth. I worked at a job where I was making about $25 an hour teaching private English lessons per each group. And I was able to create a very flexible schedule. I got a ton of teaching experience because I was able to teach several different age groups. I was being dispatched to different schools, other companies, through contracts that I got from this company, all while on a student visa. So it was definitely worth taking up that job. And it was a lot easier to go through the interview and hiring process because, once again, because I did a, you know, cold Google search on, you know, language schools in my area. And I literally like walked around my city and looked for language schools and, you know, applied to them, gave them my resume, sent them an email, whatever the case happened to be, to get interviews and to get these jobs. And I promise you, maybe 8 out of 10 of these places, if not 9 out of 10, will get back to you as long as you presented yourself nicely, gave a nice resume, and you seem like you're a professional and willing to teach seriously. I know a lot of you don't want to teach here, but honestly, it pays the most and it's the easiest job to get. So again, I'm gonna kind of speak back and forth. There's teaching jobs, there's retail jobs, there's translation work, there's all kind of stuff that you can do, but you have the best chance of making the most money as a native English speaker if you use your English ability to your advantage to make you money here. So again, don't just rely on Craigslist and Gaijinpot. Get yourself out there, walk around your neighborhood, see what language schools are out there. You'd be amazed at how many schools here don't know about Gaijinpot, don't know how to find teachers. I literally went out drinking with my friends, my coworkers, and there was actually a Japanese couple that came up to us and gave us their business cards, and they were trying to recruit us and get us to quit our job to come work for their company. So you can literally just be in the most random, weirdest of places. So of course, I suggested to them that, you know, if they're looking for foreign teachers to hire, to advertise on Gaijinpot and to utilize using Craigslist. And I, you know, apologize, like, look, I like my job. Now I kind of regret it, but you get what I mean. So anyway, a lot of Japanese people don't know about using Craigslist for job hunting. They don't know about using Gaijinpot for job hunting or job posting. So you'll actually find a lot of people that are in desperate, dire need of foreign staff, and they don't know where to go about hiring them. So normally these people go to dispatch companies and they pay a hefty fee to have somebody else do the hiring for them. But a lot of smaller schools can't afford this. So they kind of just hope by word of mouth that they can recruit a teacher some other way. So, or they use Craigslist. So again, don't be shy about sending an email directly to these schools. Do several Google searches, both in English and in Japanese. Have your friends, have your partner, have your school help you out with conducting these searches, your classmates. And I promise you, you will find tons of schools that are not listed on Craigslist or Gaijinpot, Career Cross, you know, DieJob, any of the other companies that you know of here that help you find a job. You will find so many more companies that are not listed there that are actually hiring. And you're like, how do you not know that this is where foreigners look for jobs? But again, just telling you how it goes, I highly suggest that you search for companies that are privately owned, small schools that are not franchises, because those are the places that would be more likely to hire a foreigner that's on a student visa. Generally speaking, people on student visas have a significantly harder job, finding a job in Japan, because most people don't want to be bothered with student visas. There's too many rules, too many legal issues, and a lot of people don't know how student visas work. A lot of people think that student visas are like tourist visas in which you cannot work, but that is only partially true. You're not legally allowed to work without getting permission, but after you've been granted permission, given a stamp on your visa, you are allowed to work. But a lot of schools, companies, whatever, don't know how this goes. Number 8. Search for Saturday and after school programs. Again, these companies generally work around your schedule as a student and they typically pay you the most money. Especially if you're working a Saturday job, you can get anywhere from, you know, $100 to $200 just for giving them a few hours of your day. Generally, you'll work anywhere from about 8 a.m. to no later than 3 p.m. But I would say on average, generally, you're working somewhere from like 9 to 12 or 1 p.m. or whatever. That's the entirety of your day. And I would say the average salary is somewhere between about $120 to $150 that you get for your time, which again, as a student, add that up. That's basically your rent money. So just by giving, you know, your Saturday morning away and having the lunch, you know, beyond that, you've already covered your rent just by working on Saturday. So really, you can just freelance to cover all of your electric, you know, all of your utility bills and your groceries, etc., just by giving up your Saturday. That can literally be a whole game changer, lifesaver right there by itself. I have actually done that at one point of my time when I was was living in Tokyo. It really saved my life, just working on Saturday, you know, in the daytime, in the morning, and having the rest of the week to myself where I can choose when or if I want to work in order to obviously make up enough money to have, you know, money for my groceries and my utilities. And really, I didn't even need to do that at that point because then I had student loans and financial aid that would cover those things for me. So that is definitely something really useful. A lot of people think of teaching and think of, you know, just doing evening classes or whatever, but there's a lot of after-school programs here that deal with kids. There's daycares, etc., in which they would love to have foreign English speakers to just be able to play with the kids and talk to them in English. You can find these in pretty much any major city, but even in more like suburban areas around major cities, they are definitely in need of foreigners that are willing to work random part-time hours or even set part-time hours in which they can help them out with, you know, the random load of kids they might have. Most kids here in Japan don't go to after-school programs every day, so it might be just when your parents are working on, you know, Tuesday and Thursday, or maybe Wednesday and Friday, whatever the case happens to be. So there's definitely a need for both after-school workers and Saturday school workers, because again, a lot of foreigners that are here working on, you know, work visas, they don't want to have to work on Saturday, so they need people willing to work part-time, aka mostly students, or people that are married just looking for a little side income, or those that do work Monday through Friday, but you get my point. For most people, they will feel burnt out working 6 days a week, but students definitely don't have that same experience because you're in school Monday through Friday normally, and Saturday is free for you. So for you, even if you are working, you know, Monday through Friday at another job, you're desperate for money and your hours aren't so long, so you're more willing to take on a Saturday position, and schools definitely appreciate that. Number 9. Know where to apply for a job. So this is kind of common sense. Most people kind of already know this, but keep in mind that the easiest place to get a job, which pretty much all of these jobs do require you to have at least an N4, if not N5 level of Japanese, convenience stores, grocery stores, chain restaurants like fast food or American restaurants like, you know, McDonald's or any type of family restaurant here. I forget all the names of them. What's it called? Sayanaka? Whatever the name of the place is. Haven't been there in a long time and now I'm kind of craving it. Caesarea? I always forget how to say the name of that place. Anyway, those places commonly hire foreign staff. So long story short, know where to actually apply to places that are known for hiring foreigners. Don't try to reinvent the wheel. While it is nice to, of course, find places that are willing to hire you as an individual, why make things hard for yourself? Your goal is probably to try to find work as quick as possible. And if that's the case, go where it's already been, you know, tried and proven. You will find at a lot of these family restaurants, they have a lot of foreign staff running them. There's a lot of people from Sri Lanka, from India, a lot of people from, you know, Germany, from Italy, etc., working at these places. But just as I said, most of them do have at least an N4 level of Japanese. Don't freak out if you're not there yet. I promise you, you will learn so quickly as long as you take your Japanese class seriously and you limit the amount of time you spend with foreigners. It's okay to go to parties and events, but you should not be hanging out and speaking English with people every single day. You will not learn. You also have to limit the amount of time you spend looking at and reading English things, whether it be the news, whether it be, you know, scrolling through media, whatever the case might be. You don't want to spend too much time just listening to English because it will hinder your ability to grasp and learn Japanese. The more you're surrounded by Japanese, the faster you will pick up on and learn things. Even if you can't speak, you'll be able to comprehend what's going on around you because you understand what things mean when you hear them. Also, keep in mind that tourist destinations are also a good place to look for a job. They oftentimes need people that can speak other languages besides just English, such as being able to speak Korean or Chinese or even Spanish. Vietnamese, the list goes on. So definitely, you know, look around, apply to places that you know are going to hire foreigners. Generally, fast food and convenience store places are the easiest ways to get jobs. Those are the two places that hire the most, have the highest turnover rate. Convenience stores, fast food restaurants, both Japanese and foreign places for both categories. Those are the places that you want to apply to. 7-Eleven, Lawson, Family Mart, all those type of places. Fast food like McDonald's, Wendy's, Burger King, Subway, anywhere that you see like an American place with the exception of like maybe a Baskin Robbins. Pretty much everywhere here constantly is hiring. People are constantly quitting. They are desperate for foreign workers. So if you ever cannot find a job and you really need work, a convenience store is the place to go. Them and McDonald's is definitely a close second. Number 10, don't talk about the cons. So I've kind of already made a video on this, as I said earlier, talking about the challenges of having a student visa and looking for work. But to kind of briefly summarize that here, you want to really highlight the pros to your situation. So I'm not encouraging you to lie to people, but don't give them more information than what's needed right now at the moment. Wait until you have a better chance of getting the job to reveal certain things. If you are openly telling them that you're going to school for communications or for Japanese history, most people aren't going to care about that. In fact, you're probably shooting yourself in the foot. They want somebody that already has a degree, and they want someone with a relevant degree. Your degree has nothing to do with what they'd be hiring you for, and it's not going to get you more pay. At best, if you have a nice employer, they will be happy and excited that you're learning about Japanese history or that you're learning Japanese language, but the reality is it doesn't really help your job circumstance. So you also want to be mindful that from the employer's perspective, they don't want to get in trouble from someone trying to work here illegally, being hired by them, and they don't want to have to worry about how many hours you're working. So generally, most employers, if you're working part-time, to make sure you don't get past those 28 hours, they will only allow you to work like 20 to 25 hours. They don't want any mistakes. They don't want you to have accidentally worked a little bit too much overtime, nothing. They will make sure that you stay under those 28 hours. So be very careful about what you mention inside of your resume or when interviewing, etc. You want to keep the focus on why you are qualified for the job, why you will make a good employer asset to their company. You don't want to be like, hey, I'm an American and I have a student visa, you should hire me. Some places don't mind and will hire you, don't care. Like for example, foreign-owned restaurants and places, they understand the deal. But when dealing with Japanese companies, you really want to be careful and make sure you highlight the fact that you have a legal visa, but you don't want to highlight necessarily. You should say, I have permission to work. I have a visa with permission to work. I would not highlight the fact that you're on a student visa and that you have 3 months left or something like that. Don't do that. So again, just giving you my own opinion. I'm not a lawyer. Do whatever you want to do. People have different experiences. I'm telling you what personally worked for me. So that's that. These are my 10 tips for finding a job on a student visa. There's so much more to be shared. There's so much more stuff that I probably didn't think of at the moment. And there's things that I don't and or didn't know even now. So if you have anything you'd like to add to this list, maybe you're a student living and working here, or maybe you're like me, you graduated and you no longer have a student visa, but you have advice and tips you'd like to share, please leave them in the comments down below. Otherwise, I'd appreciate it if you would like my video. And as always, please follow me on Instagram and Twitter. And I have a Snapchat that you can add me on as well, and like my Facebook page. Thank you so much for watching. Bye.